one I've got. Ain't no woman like the one I've got. Ain't no woman like the one I've got.
Every day the sun comes up around her, she can make the birds sing harmony. Every drop of rain is glad it found her. Heaven must have made her just for me. When she smiles so warm and tender, a sight for sore eyes to see.
Ooh, ain't no woman like the one I've got.
Oh, no, it don't come better.
To make her happy doesn't take a lot.
She don't ask for things, no damn reason.
So together like a hand in glove,
like pages in a letter.
Ain't no woman like the one I love.
She can feel me up when it's down.
She's a real good friend right to the end.
So together like a hand in glove.
A lonely man when she's gone.
People, ain't no woman like the one I love.
Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome to 92.3, The Four Tops. Let's pot up the microphone and get right into it. How you doing?
How you, my man? How you doing? Electrifying mojo. I've been trying to get here for a long time.
Well, I've been trying to get you here for a long time.
Well, I'm glad the feeling's mutual. I've been such a great fan of yours. Your music at night for me is exactly, I mean, as an egg, exactly the things I want to hear. So our compliments have been mutual.
Well, look, you know, I know so many people. I've known so many people through the years who've been so connected with the Four Tops because the Four Tops have been so connected with so many people. When you get a song to record and you go in and do it, I know you get presented with a lot of songs when you're a hot group. Everybody say, well, I know this is a hot tune. Let's take it to the Four Tops. When a tune comes your way, what is the factor that's crucial to making you say, well, this is the one I think we want to record?
Usually it has to do with what the song is about. And to be very specific about songs like that you're speaking of, say songs like Nature Planted or Still Waters Run Deep or Ain't No Woman Like the One I've Got, those particular songs that usually, the songs that we recorded that have touched people in one deep way or another, were usually songs that were tailor-made for us. They were not usually the ones that people just bring to us. They were, as you go in the tailor shop, someone sit there and just design that song for you to deliver, knowing that you could deliver that song with that message like that. And that's how fortunate we've been with recordings in that sense. And when we don't have a tailor-made song, believe it or not, it's pretty hard, as well as Levi can interpret mostly any song, to get that. Once you hear it song, there's a song, there's songs that we sing, once you hear it, once we hear it, we know that that's a hit, that's a message, or that's something that millions of people will understand. A lot of times we just record and we try to get that, but we don't always come up with it. But when we do, we just know it. We just all hear it almost simultaneously. And those songs are just like, I guess just like if you heard a record that just came, if you had a selection of 10 songs on your desk, you know which one that would hit you the most as soon as you heard it. You would say, that's my kind of song. I'll play that night in and night out. Mm-hmm. Same way with a song with us, when we hear it, we know that's specifically for us. And fortunately or unfortunately, the ones that touch people like that were the ones that were basically, 99% of the times were tailor-made for us for that.
Who are the Four Tops?
The Four Tops are four wonderfully blessed human beings right from the middle of Detroit that have grown up together. They've been friends throughout a lot of things. We became friends in school. We all used to sing in different little groups. Some of us were sport enthusiasts. We were on athletic teams in the high schools, which is way back. But still, we were Detroiters. And as we got out of school, in our last years of high school, we were around Detroit winning amateur shows. Once we found out that the four of us had a great sound together, we won practically all the amateur shows in all the different neighborhoods. And one agent came up to us at one time and said, look, whenever you guys are ready, I have some professional engagements for you, because you guys, I think, can do that. So we graduated from high school. I graduated at a crazy time, which was January. A couple of us had sports scholarships to go to college, Central State to be exact. But we didn't really have the money to go. You know, I didn't want to go. Obi and I, myself, he went to Cass High. Levi went to Pershing with me, and Lawrence went to Northern. Anyway, Obi and I, we just did not really have the money to go. So we said, why don't we try singing for a while? Get up enough money. Him and I was going to buy a car together and get some clothes and scoot on down to Wilberforce, Ohio. You know, that's the way the plan began. But anyway, we worked our first professional engagement up in Flint at a place called Eddie's Lounge. And ever since that first engagement, we've just been totally locked in.
So you got together as a group to finance your way through school.
More or less.
Not knowing that you were getting ready to finance your way through life.
Well, we knew we wanted to sing, but you know, we were at the crossroads of our life when we're trying to make those decisions. We know singing was definitely part of it, because all of us have always sung all our whole life, whether it was in church, whether it was in school, whether it was in choirs, whatever. We've always done it all our whole life. But I also know I should be going to school. I mean, my parents have told me, you got to go to school and you got a scholarship. I mean, it would be ludicrous not to use this. But once we started singing professionally, we all knew right then and there what we were going to do for the rest of our lives. So we just went on the journey of learning our craft. While we were, well, we were called like cabaret singers then. We could sing like any other group. We were called the Four Ames, by the way. And we really had no particular sound. We could sing like the Four Freshmen. We could sing like the Mills Brothers. We could sing like the Clovers. We could sing like the Dominoes. We could sing like the Four Tops, but nobody knew what that sound was like. It was a mixture of all that. And so we really didn't concentrate on recording. We concentrated on being a singing group and learning how to entertain. So for about 10 years, that's all we did, was just travel, entertain, and learn our craft. But in between, we would record.
At what moment did you realize how much impact that the Four Tops were having on the lives of so many people?
That came quite a while, way after we came to Motown even. Prior to coming to Motown, like I said, we were learning our craft. We knew some things happened to us that we knew we were destined to do something, and then something wonderful. And we really learned how to live with each other. We learned how to share everything, right down to the last cracker and salami. We learned how to share three pair of pants when there were four of us, and things like that. Things like that. But by the time we got to Motown, we tried recording with different people. And then Barry, a stroke of genius, put three writers, producers, Holland, Doge, and Holland, with us. He says, guys, why don't you just get with these guys, the Four Tops, and just kind of study them and come up with something good for them. I think you'd be perfect for them. Well, they did. Now, they studied us for about a year, watched us while we were doing engagements, watched us in the studio. We became great friends. And then he wrote this one fantastic song. It was called Baby, I Need Your Lovin'. But even then, you know, after the first record came out and after I realized it was a hit, I mean, I didn't know we were making an impact on the world. We were then just starting to have fun.
another day, another night. I long to hold you tight, 'cause I'm so lonely.
To having a hit record on the radio when you were just performing and getting great response. After that first hit record came out there, what was it like? I mean, what was the difference between the two stages?
The difference between the two stages probably was, first of all, there was an extra feeling of confidence and much more fun, because you were actually singing a song that people wanted and was dying, not just wanted, dying to hear you do. And the moment you start singing that song, which we were not used to, people were going bonkers. I mean, they were standing up and we're used to getting great applauses and wonderful responses and all those subtle, wonderful things, and even standing ovations without hit records. But when you sung that first hit, I mean, people would just go crazy. There were kids, they would just start dancing and all over and whooping and screaming. It was almost, you couldn't even really almost hear the song. You couldn't hear yourself sing. And that was a truly new experience to me. And that's what I'm saying by meaning this, that the fun just begun. That was part of the big fun, is that great feeling between stage when all you had to do was basically show up, and put that music on. And they take it away from you, which was great. And you just keep trying to get it back. And we just had bundles of fun. I mean, I think we fell more and more in love with the stage more after every hit, because it become more and more intense. I mean, now, instead of one hit, here comes two you can do. Then the third one. Pretty soon you had a whole show of hits. I mean, whereas, after the first hit, you had to sing three or four songs and try to save the hit for the last or the strongest part of the show. If you just had one hit, when you have two, then you can put one near the front and one near the back. When you got three, you can put one in the front, one in the middle, and one in the back. And so on and so on. And so pretty soon, you have got nothing but hits. And that is what you call it. I guess you call that jackpot. But it becomes more and more fun after each one.
Many a tear has to fall, but it's all in the game.
In a while,
We're here with the Duke from the Four Tops, live in the studio. We are just reminiscing a few Four Tops memories. I was up north, near Baldwin. This was around October.
Well, you know, up near Baldwin, there's a place about 3 miles from Baldwin, Michigan, where every summer we would spend the whole summer between the years of 55 and maybe early 60s. It was called Idlewild, Michigan.
That's what I
heard of it.
That's what I heard.
That turned us totally out. I mean, Idlewild was one of the greatest places for us being in the business and to grow up, as well as learning about life. You know, the great people from Detroit, Chicago, Cleveland, and all the other neighboring cities would come up. I mean, people of all walks of lives, you know, from plumbers to doctors to teachers. And they would spend those weeks and weekends together. We were intermingling with all these people, as well as entertaining them with a Las Vegas-type show up there. And just the things we learned, the things we experienced, and the fun that we had while doing, I guess you would call it a job, doing our thing. It was a great... great experience. From July the 4th through Labor Day, we would be there, and we never really wanted to come home after that.
What kind of people were up there? I mean, during that time, I understand that there was nothing for the other Duke Ellington to be there.
Or Della Reese, or Jackie Wilson would come in, or at that time, Brooke Minton, or whoever. Whoever were Dakota Staton, whoever were the big record-selling artists, they would come up. Maybe they wouldn't come up but for a weekend, but they would come up and join right in and be in the middle of the show. But what was so great about it, it was so educational. I mean, to everyone, people really intermingled. We intermingled with each other. You know what I mean by that? I mean, professional people, hard blue-collar working people, nightlife people, entertainers, you name it. I mean, they totally intermingled. You see them on the beach together, or you'd see them at the club during the middle of the day eating or playing baseball and basketball, maybe with Goose Tatum, but be playing baseball with the guys that worked around the clubs, or you just name it, and the people really intermingled. And I think we surely miss something like that now. It would be just great for all of us, because I learned so much from a lot of the people that were there, the professional people, people that I would just talk to. You know, it was like getting an education. Wow, you guys are great, but you should learn how to do this and learn how to do this. And they didn't mind giving you wonderful advice. I mean, there were so many friends that helped us on the way. But, you know, and in places like that, you could sit down and just talk to them. And they didn't mind giving you that information or advice or whatever you want to call it, or just talk to you, sit there and be pitching to the line for whatever you pitch to the line for. Say we all pitch the line, everybody, one person, everybody lunch, and then they would share ideas with each other, and you learn so much. It was such a school for me, as well as having fun. We as black people really need something like that. That's when I was like a black resort. But even on the weekends, the white people would come, the whites would come, but it was our place, and we shared it with each other. That we don't have anymore, and we surely miss it, believe me.
Someone told me that a move was underway to put that whole project back together. I don't know how substantial.
If not there, the idea, you know, the idea of what it, the concept, just something that we could have, that we could do, where we could relax and enjoy and do things that we all appreciate doing just as human beings, and sit there and share ideas. I mean, that's a lot of strength. There's a lot of coming together, and there's a lot of moving forward on different things that would come out of that, that we, as a community, need that. Maybe one day when I'm off the road, because I can help put some stuff together. But, you know, traveling and being part of love and music, it keeps you thinking about people.
Right.
I mean, that's the wonderful part of what we do. It keeps you in a loving mode, you know, because all you get is the good side of people. You know, I don't usually see, unless I turn on the TV, the bad side of people, basically. When I see them, they're coming to give me a standing ovation, or they give me some of the love that they have, and I'm giving them love back. So it's a total exchange of wonderful things, and it's been very fruitful for the four of us, and it's kept us very whole.
Take my hand. Take
92.3 FM. We're here with the Duke.
Baby, baby. Oh, yeah. Just seven numbers can straighten out my life. But my pride won't let me fall. Just seven numbers can't put me through you, girl. Then I'll know you're really at home. You haven't been fair to me. Playing on my jealousy. You say you see some other guy. I don't know the truth from the lie. If I only knew where you were. Just seven numbers can straighten out my life. If my fingers would only turn the dial. Seven numbers can put me through you, girl. Just your hello would make me smile. I haven't been fair to myself. I tried to call someone else, but after she said I hung up the telephone line. If I only knew where you were. Just seven numbers.
Point 3 FM, Electrifying Mojo. We're here live with the Duke from the Four Tops. Let me ask you, you've been all over the country, you've been all over the world. How much do you tour a year now? I mean, do you tour a lot?
We tour a lot. We tour 6 to 7 months out of the year. And if you average it out, Mojo, it would probably be, you could probably say we work weekends, all weekends, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sundays, or Friday, Saturday, and Sundays. If you average it out, we're the type of group, we would rather work constantly through the year. We don't like to work 2 months and take 2 months off. You know, you get way out of whack for what you're doing if you're off that long. You know what I mean by that?
Mm-hmm.
And it's such a pleasurable job that we have. I hate to call it a job because I have so many other names for it. But it's a, you know, it's a pleasurable thing that we do, that I'd rather intertwine it in my life throughout the whole year. And that's basically how the first year we sit down and pretty much plan every year. Our year, and it pretty much goes close to the same. And then sometimes we take time out to go, you know, across the waters and back for different things. But mostly we do maybe 8 weeks in Vegas, 3 weekends in Atlantic City. And we do some theaters and rounds. We do some regular theaters like the Fox Theater that we're going to be at, and that we're going to be at 21st. And we do maybe 10 cities like that with those type of theaters. We also do a lot of corporate engagements. You could say General Motors is having their big achievers party for their greatest salesman or their fleet salesman. They have a party in Hawaii and the big banquet and meetings and so forth. Sometimes, I said groups like us, they would send for us, and we would sing at their banquet. And we stay there maybe 5-6 days to perform one show, and they would take care of most expenses, all expenses actually. And the corporate world is big for us. It's just as big as like working the Fox twice a year. Mm-hmm. We work for IBM, General Motors, Ford, you name it. All these people that are executives and so forth, they were the ones that were buying the records in the 60s, and that's the kind of music they want to hear, and it's working out fine for us, Mojo.
All right. Look, after you, I just want to ask you if you would look back over the many songs that the Four Tops have had the pleasure of recording, is there one song that stands out?
Oh, it's absolutely with me. It's not a second song to me. Now, there's one song that stands out to me, with me. That's my favorite song of all time. And then I'm going to tell you my favorite song that sold a lot of records. My favorite song that we've recorded of all time is MacArthur Park. That's a song that every time it's done, that we do it, and anyone else could do it. It's something about that song that brings a tear to my eye. It's something in that song that just kind of hits me where I need to be hit all the time, and it just always keeps me very earthy, and it's just something warm and wonderful about that. And I just love that song. More so when we do it, but anyone can do it, and I love the song. Then for the songs that we really sold a lot of records, the most commercial songs that we've done, Baby, I Need Your Lovin' is my favorite of that.
Mm-hmm.
But for just straight out singing Touch Me, MacArthur Park, that's mine.
Well, I'll make a deal with you. I'm going to play my favorite song by the Four Tops.
Okay.
And then I'm going to play your favorite song.
But it sounds like a winner to me. I can't lose.
You have any idea what my favorite song is by the Four Tops?
No, but you tell me.
Okay, I'll tell you. I was on the radio. I got a call from this lady. I had a very serious reason to believe that she meant everything she said. She said that she was on the verge of suicide.
Mm.
That life had basically disappointed her. That she had known nothing but pain and a lot of suffering, and she didn't want to deal with it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
At first, I thought she was trying to get attention, but then I had some reasons to believe, based on some other things that she said, that she was very, very serious. And I said, well, I could just shrug this off and just say, oh, well. Or I could seriously try to connect with this lady and
mm-hmm.
let her know that she was looking at the wrong end of things, that there's two sides to every coin.
Absolutely.
And I was looking for a record to play for. You know, a lot of people, they don't really need much, but they do need to know that someone is out there.
That somebody loves you.
And somebody really, you know, is concerned.
Oh, concerned, yeah.
And I popped the song on. When I told her to listen to the song, I lost her on the line. And I really felt bad about that, because I didn't know if I had accidentally hung up on her or whether or not she had done it. And but I just started kicking out some jams, and I played this song. And I just basically told a little story about how life is like sunshine and rain and joy and pain. And I said, but tonight, listen to this radio station. Listen to this radio, because there's a person inside of this radio that's talking to you, and then I play the song. Confusion until happiness is just an illusion. This is 92.3 WMXD Detroit. We're here with the Duke from the Four Tops.
I'm here with Electrifying Mojo.
Look, now, after I played that song and I lost that lady on the line, I got a...
What happened? I must know what happened.
I got a letter in the mail about a month later, and because I felt bad about that for a few days, because, you know, I didn't know whether, you know, this lady was living or dead. Mm-hmm. I got a letter in the mail, and she said, I don't know if you remember or not, but a month ago, you took the time with a very disillusioned lady to try to show her a different side of things. You played some songs, and after that night, I immediately picked myself up, and I've been running ever since, and I just want to let you know that that I think I'm alive because someone took the time to care.
Well, let me ask you: was that as gratifying to you as I think it would be? That would have to be one of the most gratifying moments of your career or life.
Well, you know, I read the letter over and over and over, and it was like a light came on every time I picked up that letter. And I think it's songs like that that the Four Tops recorded that reached out to so many people all over the world.
And back to what I was saying about writers, Holland Dozier and Holland, the writers, the tailors of the Four Tops sound and music at that time, knew and felt like this. I mean, they were so good at coming up with the right song at the right time. They knew the world needed, the world was in need of hope, and this was definitely a hope song. And then they wrote it, and when Barry heard it, he said, Duke, he called us up in the office, says, Duke, this is going to be the biggest record you've ever had. And I said, well, I liked it okay, but I didn't think it was going to be nothing of the magnitude that he said it was going to be. And it was. It was the record that commercially sold more than any other record that we've had, and it reached us out and reached out across to everyone across the world. I mean, that made us universal, whatever you might want to call it. The love for the Four Tops just totally traveled around the world and back again from that song, and that certainly catapulted us. And it also saved, hopefully, a lot of lives. I think, you, like you did, you know, isn't it nice to know that you have saved a life?
You know what I mean? Well, you know, I've been wanting to do an interview with the Four Tops for quite some time, and basically to share with you that particular story and that particular song, because it was the Four Tops interpretation of the lyrics written by Holland Dozier.
Well, you're right, because we all feel that way.
Because, you know, you can write, and this is to take nothing away from HDH.
I understand.
But you can write things down, but if you're going to have to depend on interpreters to carry your feelings from the heart to the ears of the world, then you better have the right interpreters.
Well, you're absolutely correct, and I think Four Tops, and especially Levi, is one of the greatest interpreters of lyrics in the world. I mean, he sings what he feels, and what he feels is what's inside of him, and what's inside of him is a pretty big heart. You know what I mean?
All right.
A lot of love there. And he interprets tremendously. He's just a great interpreter. And we try very hard. You know, we try very hard to feel what we do. And the things that we feel without trying are the things that just go straight to the top. Right now, we're just finishing up with... We went back to our roots. We went back and got a producer we never really worked with but on one song. Norman Whitfield, who wrote and produced most of the stuff for The Temptations. We just... basically, just about finished an album with him that is going to be a tremendous, tremendous true album of the Four Tops of the 90s. We're not trying to do anything but what we feel, and it's just a 90s. You know, people have been trying to produce us different other than Norman knows how to produce us. Everyone at Motown would know how to produce this, because there's a way that you go in there to get what you need to come out of there with. And that's, first of all, have the song. After the song, there's a process of extracting that song and putting it on wax so that it comes through your heart and through your bloodstream. And when you get that on tape, you got smashes. So anyways, this is going to be an event, and we're very, very pleased about it.
Well, look, I'm looking forward. You know, the song that you told me that was your favorite song, I have to tell you, I'm going to play it now because I'm not going to be selfish and just play the one that was my favorite. But it is possible to have two favorites at one time. And I think that this song is probably one of the deepest songs ever written. It's a song that could be whatever you want it to be. If you want it to be a love song, if you want it to be a song about the lessons life has to offer, if you want it to be a song where some people like to listen to sad songs. Some people, they can humble themselves, you know, when a sad song is on and think about it. But this song, it's kind of sad, but it's also kind of inspiring.
It has a release to it, which you could say is inspiring. It has a sadness about it, but when I mean the release, there's also a place where you can open up and there's a happiness that flows in there also. To me, it's just like it's a combination of songs. It's a song, it's songs within a song.
Let's just say it's a miniature opera or something.
Yes, this is a concerto. a mini
feelings. We're here with the Duke from the Four Tops, and
this is going to be a preview. You just got one of us. Next time, when all four of us here, we're going to have to take the whole night. You know that, don't you?
Well, you know, they're listening right now. So
that's why our listeners are up too.
Cab down there, Duke down there by himself. But one thing about it, we've talked about the group, and we've talked about the Four Tops.
Yeah, and my friends. And I want to say hi to my families out there. I mean, we've had great support from our wives and our kids. We have great families. You know, we've got a great support system. You know, not only the Four Tops support themselves, you know, each other, but our families, our wives, you know, our kids, mothers, aunts, cousins. I mean, some guys we grew up with, you know, the guys that we hang with sometimes, the guys we go to the gym with. I mean, that's a support system that you can't get anywhere but home. And Detroit is home.
Was never waiting for us, girl. It ran one step ahead as we followed in the dance. Between the parted pages and the pressed, and love's hot fevered iron, like a striped pair of pants. Is melting in the dark. All the sweet green ice is flowing down. Someone left the cake out in the rain. I don't think that I can take it, 'cause it took so long to bake it, and I'll never have that recipe again. I still see the yellow cotton dress foaming like a wave on the ground around your knees. And the birds like tender babies on your hand, and the old man playing checkers by the trees. Melting in the dark. All the sweet green ice is flowing down. Someone left the cake out in the rain. I don't think that I can take it, 'cause it took so long to make it. recipe again.
It's 92.3 FM, Electrify Mojo. We're here with the Duke from the Four Tops, and I'd like to thank you for coming down to the studio.
Oh, it's been my pleasure. What a joy to talk with you. And then say hello to the friends of Detroit. You know, I'd be dying to talk to my friends out there. We've got so many of them.
Well, look here, they're all on these telephone lines right now, and I just want you to know that the, and I speak collectively on behalf of all of the fans out there, not just in Detroit, but all around the world. The Four Tops have recorded some of the most inspirational songs for the heart, songs that help you express things that are deep down inside of you. And on so many occasions, so many people would not have been able to get all of those messages out had it not been for the Four Tops.
Well, I'd just like to thank the listening ears and their big accepting hearts to just reach out and pick those songs up, because it certainly has helped us in continuing on with our career, because we are givers of love music. That's our blessing from the man above.
Let's give Duke and the Four Tops a standing ovation.
Whee! Take it, smile. My electrified mojo, I'm there.
You know that I love you. Can't help myself. I love you and nobody else. In and out my life, in and out you come and you go. With your picture behind, and I just feel a thousand times. Spend this night with finger, or with your eye, I come running to you.
92.3 FM, Electrify Mojo.
You're listening to Electrify Mojo, Rare Moments. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. Do not ever leave home without your mask. Do not ever cook food for you or anyone else without your mask. Do not serve food without your mask. Do not talk to anyone without your mask. And that's 6 feet away. The 6 foot distancing from another person is not a substitute for wearing your mask. It's plus wearing your mask. What are the consequences of not staying 6 feet apart? It could be a decision to stay 6 feet apart or being 6 feet under. The safest place for you is at home. If you must leave home, keep a 6 foot distance from whomever you encounter. Wash your hands constantly. Do not touch your face. Wear disposable gloves wherever you go. Dispose of those gloves once you're back in your safe location. Good friends keep good friends 6 feet away so they can live to see another day. That is the new meaning of friendship. I give 6 foot fist pumps for days, 6 feet away.